We're so glad to have you all back with us. This is session three, Got the Job, Now What? Kelly is going to get us started off here with Ian did another video for us. I hope you enjoy.
What's up, guys? It's Ian with Kentucky Spin, and today I want to give you three things to think about for your third session, which is Got the Job, Now What? So here we go.
I got paid today.
What is that?
This is a paycheck stub. But like, I don't understand gross pay and net pay. Like, what is that?
Gross pay is all $4.
Okay.
Net pay is the one you keep after I take three.
Okay. What? Wait. Come back, Mama. Come back, Mama. All right. Just $999.99 until I can go on that trip. Okay, guys, again, as with the other two, I hope it was funny. I hope you got something from it. But on a serious note, I want to go over the three things we went over and just kind of talk about the seriousness of it and kind of how it will help you once you do have the job and how to be successful moving forward. So number one, the first paycheck, what do you do with it? You definitely want to put it in your bank account. Hopefully you have a bank account. And either whether savings or checking, it doesn't matter, but just kind of getting used to that, portioning whatever amount you feel is appropriate in savings and putting the rest in checking and, you know, balancing all that stuff and getting a budget together. All these are good fundamental things to start thinking about once you get employment. Two, the second thing I went over is the difference between gross pay and net pay. And that is a real thing where your net is going to be what you get after taxes are removed and different things that come out of your paycheck. So that is going to be the tangible amount that you actually can cash in the check. Your gross is going to be the amount that is the full amount without taxes or anything removed. And that is kind of what a lot of society uses for things like income and what could you afford in terms of housing and things like that. So keep that in mind, but kind of understand the difference between the two. And number three, pay yourself first. This goes back to savings. We all have bills, we all have expenses, but make sure when you get paid, do something nice for yourself and pay yourself first for the work that you put in. Even if it's something small, just make sure you do that to get the enjoyment out of it. And to, so it's not so, you know, intense going to work and, you know, working however many hours you're working. Do something to reward yourself for being consistent and doing well at your new position. Okay, guys, it's Ian with Kentucky Spin. I hope these tips have been helpful. I hope you enjoy your session. Until next time, see ya.
Well, hello, everyone. I'm Michaela Evans with Kentucky Spin, and I'm so excited to talk to you guys today. I am a parent educator. That's technically my job title. But today, I also have a teenage son with autism. So we are actually living through a lot of the stuff that I'm going to talk to you about today. So now that we have talked about preparing for that interview and presenting your best self and what to do during the interview. And now that you've rocked the interview, we're going to talk about what happens when you get the job. So there are several different factors that can affect how you get paid, and it's going to look a little different for everyone. There are lots of options out there to help because not everyone is great at managing their money, and that's okay. So it may look a little different for some of you as you go into adulthood. You may have a guardian, and that's just a legal tool that allows another person to make decisions for another adult, or you may have a conservator, which is a type of guardian who only manages a person's finances and their money. And then there's also supported decision making, which is really helpful because it's just simply using your trusted friends and family, maybe some professionals that you're close with, that we all need to help make our own decisions. And these people really can help you in evaluating a situation, weighing your pros and cons, exploring your options, and offering advice based on their experience, and explaining maybe some things that are complicated, like documents or different financial concepts. But it may look a little different for everybody. But if you are planning on trying to manage your own money, there are some skills that you will need to master first. So some of those skills that we're going to talk about in this session are, you know, where you keep your money, how to read your paycheck whenever you get that, how to make a budget, and how to save money for the future. So where do you put your money once you get that first paycheck? You have a couple of different options. A bank or a credit union is a safe place to put your money. Credit unions are nonprofit and they're usually community-based. They are very similar to a bank where you can deposit your money and keep it safe. But to use a credit union, you usually involves paying a fee. And all credit unions specialize first and foremost on their services that they offer to members of the credit union. And they encourage you to save and use your money wisely. When you're talking about a bank, that's also a place where you can deposit your money and keep it safe. But unlike the credit union, you don't join and become a member of a bank. You become one of their customers. And so banks are interested in earning a profit from their customers. So you may find that if you open a bank account with a traditional bank, that the fees with the bank are higher than a credit union. And so you also have several options on how to access your money once you choose, you know, if you want to put it in a bank or a credit union. And so you can have your check deposited directly into your bank by your job, which is great. It's very convenient. And when that happens, it'll automatically go on a debit card, which is this blue card that you see down here to look very similar to that. And it'll be available right away. You can withdraw cash at the bank at the ATM that you see up here in the yellow picture. And we'll talk about the ATM a little bit more in just a second. But the debit card is a plastic card connected to your account at either the bank or the credit union. And when you make purchases using this card, money is immediately taken from your checking or savings account to cover the cost. So debit cards can be used for the withdrawal of cash also. And you can also use, when you go to some stores, they have an option for cash back. And so you swipe your card and you pay for your purchase and you can get select the option to get cash back if you don't have time to go buy an ATM or there's not one handy. But be aware that there can be fees for that sometimes. And then almost
I also thought, especially some people prefer getting their checks like in paper form, and some businesses may not offer direct deposit. So you can actually deposit them in person at your bank, but it will be a few days before that money is available on your debit card. But also too, and one of the things that was brought up, I thought was so very important on Wednesday's session was making sure that you don't overdraw and spend more money than you really have using that debit card. You may have checks that you have written that are out to pay bills and you never know when that'll be deposited. So you've got to be very careful that you don't do an overdraft, is what they call it, because not only will you get a fee, that means that you spent money that you don't have, you're going to get a fee fine for that, not only for then, but every day that your account is overdrawn, there will be a fee. And many times you will not find that out if you don't pay attention to go in and check your bank account very often. You may not find out till they mail you a letter and tell you. And the way mail's running these days, it could take 5, if not 7 days for you to get that. And you not only have overdrafted what you didn't have, but you have a lot of fees that you will encounter for that. I just want to make sure everybody knows how important it is to make sure that when you are spending that and when you write the check, that money's gone. Don't even think of it as your money anymore, because that will really help you so you don't overdraw.
Absolutely. And so it's very important to make sure you're not just swiping that card blindly and to keep up with those transactions. So a debit card may not be the best option for everyone. You just really have to decide, you know, what is good for you. And the card will also let you access the ATM, and you just keep in mind that the ATM that is not your bank, you can get cash out at the ATM up here. But if it's not an ATM that belongs to your bank, it will charge you a fee as well. So those are just some things to be mindful of. Of course, some people don't have a bank or a credit union account and they cash their paycheck. So if you get a paper check and you want to go cash it at either a check cashing store or at Walmart or a lot of grocery stores or other businesses offer check cashing services, things you want to consider when doing that is it is going to cost you money to cash your check. They will take a fee out of that, and it's different depending on different businesses. But you also want to think about if you are going to be responsible enough to carry around all of your cash. That is something that we're working with my son on right now. He has a hard time keeping up with cash, and even his wallet, if he puts his cash in his wallet, sometimes we'll lose the wallet. So for him, a debit card is really a better option because if he loses that, we can call and cancel it so that nobody else has access to his money. Like I said, there are benefits and drawbacks to all of the options, but you really just have to choose which one is the best for you. And if you don't know right away, that's okay. Sometimes it's trial and error, and you just really have to see how it works out for you. And so when we're talking about checking accounts, I'm sorry, let me go back here. A checking account is a service that gives customers a way to pay their bills either by check or directly online and to deposit money. And so some of the banks or credit unions may charge a monthly fee for checking accounts. Often banks or credit unions offer debit cards like we talked about that are linked to that account. A savings account is a secure place to keep your money for the future, not anything that you're really going to spend right away. Some people use them to save up for big things like a vacation or an expensive purchase or to buy a car. Savings accounts normally pay you a small amount of interest. And so interest is money that you can earn on top of the money that you already have in your account. It's usually a very small amount and depends on how much you have in that savings account. But one of the benefits is that the bank will actually pay you, sometimes just a few cents, depending on what's in there, for having your money in that account and keeping it there. So that's free money. And it's really a great option for everyone. And so what will you need when you...
Well, I was just going to say, who doesn't love some free money? That doesn't happen very often. And one of the things I just wanted to share that Stella had shared, one of the things that that they do that helps Clayton with money is that he only carries about $10 cash on him and a debit card also, because that helps him and what works best for him. There's also something that she had told us that she had got her husband and Clayton, because they might tend to lose their wallets. There is something which I didn't even know about till this week from Stella, that there's a thing called a TAO, which is a card that has like a GPS And if you tend to lose your wallet, it can actually, you could go online and it will help you find your wallet. And that is just genius, because I think I need that on not just my wallet, but maybe everything. So.
Yes, the way that technology has really helped us out in the last few years is really amazing. And one of the things we'll talk about later is, you know, there's an app for that, because there's an app for everything. So as simple as just placing something in your wallet, and then you can pull up on an app wherever it is really a great option that has not been out there in previous years, and something I may actually look into changing the way that we do things as well, because it's super helpful. So thank you, Stella and Rhonda, for that information. One of the things that we're going to talk about is, you know, what you need if you choose to open a checking or savings account. There are several things you'll need to bring with you. Some of those things include a social security card or your social security number. You'll need photo identification, like a driver's license or an ID card, like Stella had talked about earlier this morning. You want proof of your current address, such as a utility bill. So if you have a bill in your name, like a phone bill or an electric bill, it comes to you at your address, that is perfect. If you do not have a bill in your name, but you have, say, a letter from the school that came to, it says, to the parents of in your name, you can take that as your proof of address as well. And then, of course,
and Michaela, I thought about another one that I know I keep chiming in, but I thought about another one is, if you don't even have that letter from the school, have someone write you and send you a letter. And as long as it has been postmarked that it showed it was delivered to you at that address, that is your proof you need as well.
That's a great idea. That's awesome. I had never thought about that. You'll also need to be prepared to bring money with you when you open an account, because most banks or credit unions require that you have a specific amount to open the account. So you may want to call or stop by and check ahead of time as to what you'll need to bring with you and what amount of money you'll need to open an account. Banks and credit unions, they're all different. So call and ask them what the minimum deposit is and what else you should bring if you want to open an account. So now that you've got that first paycheck, we're going to talk about what's on it. And that involves gross pay and net pay. Gross earnings are the total amount of your income. To figure out your gross earnings is basically exactly how much you expect to get paid per hour, or what your salary is for that job. And that's your total amount of money, gross. However, the government does take out taxes and deductions before you see that money. And so net pay is what you actually get in your pocket from that paycheck. And so we will talk a little bit about, you know, who are these people and why are they taking our money, right? The chart here will help us show which deductions come out of your check and who they go to. So the biggest part here is what you're going to keep. And this will be the amount that you actually get to cash or put into your bank and you can spend. The federal income tax, which is this gray amount right here, and that's money that goes to the federal government to pay for things like military, health care, roads, and parks. You're also going to have a state income tax. In Kentucky, we have a state income tax. And that money goes to the state of Kentucky to pay for things like our schools, public health clinics, museums, and libraries. Then you may have a local wage tax, and that money goes directly to your city or the town where you live, and that pays for things like the local fire department, the police department, and different community projects. And then, of course, everybody has Social Security tax taking out of their check, and that money goes to the Social Security Trust Fund, and it pays for retirement, disability, and survivorship benefits. So qualifying minors that may have lost a parent sometimes get survivorship benefits, or if you have a disability. And then, of course, once you reach a certain age, you will get to draw retirement Social Security money. So that's where that goes to. And then the Medicare tax is money that helps support healthcare for our elderly population and some people with permanent disabilities. And so when you're figuring how much money you need to spend each month, always use your net earnings because this is the amount that you actually get to keep.
And also keep in mind too, a lot of jobs, if it is not a typical set certain amount of hours that you work a week, keep in mind too that your actual net and gross can vary depending upon how many hours that week you worked. So you'll have to be very mindful of that when you're budgeting, because a lot of times, and especially when you're younger, you may work varying hours. It may be 15 hours this week, 20 hours next week. So keep that in mind, unless you have a set amount of time each week that you are guaranteed that you'll get, that's going to vary, and you don't want to count on that money if it is not a stable set hours.
Absolutely. And so what Rhonda was just talking about here in the blue, this is a sample paycheck, so you can actually see what I'm talking to you about, and I'm hoping that will help a little bit better. But these deductions here that they took out, that's a total of $191.88. But it's based on them working 40 hours over here. And if you don't work the amount of hours, these numbers are going to change every time. So they may not always be the same, depending on what your job is and how you get paid. But just be prepared for some of this to come out. So this person worked 40 hours and their gross wages were $970. That means the total amount that they would get paid. But once they take out these deductions over here, the Social Security tax, federal income tax, Medicaid or Medicare tax that we talked about, once you take that away, you get your net pay. So this down here in the green is what this person gets to actually put in their pocket and they can spend. That's $778.12. So another thing I want to talk to you about is making a budget. And a budget is a plan for saving and spending money and putting off making a plan for your money. Really, it can affect your life today and tomorrow. So to make a budget, you need to know how much income you have. So that's the money you have coming in and how much you got paid on that net pay on your paycheck. And you need to know how you're spending that money and how many expenses or bills that you have to pay out of that check. And then you can make your budget. So like I said, first you have to figure out your income. How much money do you have each month? And it might look a little bit different, you know, if you're working different hours every time. But I would usually say if you know you're going to get at least 10 hours every week, budget for that. Even if you get between 10 and 15 hours, I would say budget on the low end. And that way any extra money you have is left over at the end of the month. And then you need to figure out, the second thing you need to figure out is what bills do you have and where are you currently spending your money? The last thing that you need to work out is how much money you have left over at the end of each month. And so this is just an example of a budgeting worksheet. So if you're the type of person that likes to write it all down on pen and paper, you can write down your needs. And things like that would be your utilities. You're going to have electric or water bill if you're out on your own. or, you know, maybe you're at home with your parents, but you're going to pay your phone bill. So these are all things that are needs. Groceries or a food allowance is also a need, and you'll need to account for that. But we also have wants. And so some of the things that we want may be, you know, a new pair of shoes, or going out to dinner with a friend. And so you would plan the amount that you're going to spend on each of these things for your needs and wants. And then you're going to keep track about how much you actually spend, because it's very common to actually spend way more money, or not necessarily way more money, but just more money in general than you had planned on. And I know in my household, we are always busy and on the go. We don't always have a lot of time to cook. And my son does not have good cooking skills himself. So if mom's not here, we're usually running through a drive-through or grabbing something quick to eat. And so we spend a lot more money usually than I budget for on food. And so those are just things, an example of things that come up. And you want to keep track of what you're actually spending, because what we plan to spend and what we actually spend is usually a little different.
Well, and I have found for myself, I got to make myself take care of those bills first, because if I do the other first, go grocery shopping, I can spend more quicker than I even intended. And then you don't want to find yourself like I have, where you've got to get those bills covered, because you got to make sure you take care of those necessities first. It's one of those lovely things about being grown.
Yes. And that ties into what we're going to go over right now, which is, you know, spending less than your income. That's the goal. So spending less than your income is good, and that's called a surplus. And it means that you have money left over after you have paid for all of your needs and even some of your wants. And that means you're in good shape. So when you plan a budget at the beginning of the month, plan to spend less than your expected income. At the end of the month, compare your total spending for your needs and your wants to your actual total monthly income, like we had talked before on the worksheet on the previous slide. And so spending more than your income is not so good. That's called a deficit. And so it means that you have overspent, and it's time to look at, you know, where you're spending too much. In my house, it's usually goes to food. So like Rhonda said, make sure you go to the grocery store first and you have food in the house. And then if you have money left over after you've taken care of your bills and your groceries and you want to grab a quick bite to eat, definitely can do that. But you want to make sure everything's taken care of first. And so what do you do if your actual spending is greater than your income? Really, it's going to have to either come out of your savings or by borrowing money, and you can get yourself into a lot of financial trouble by doing that. So I really encourage you to steer clear of overspending or borrowing money, even if it's from savings, borrowing it from yourself. And if you find yourself spending more than you had for the month, don't panic. Just take a look at where it was that you overspent and see if you can cut spending for things like entertainment. So like, if you don't have to have, you know, the internet for work, we might could, you know, cut a bill there. Or if you're going out to the movies every weekend with friends, maybe you can cut that somewhere. Or you could stop eating out. And in your next budget, just make sure you plan to spend less on your wants and try to stick to the plan. And that's how you control your finances.
Well, and I find that sometimes just substituting a cheaper version, whatever it is that you're looking at, sometimes can help you greatly there. We're at the, I know you can't see it, but the 15-minute mark.
So the good news is there's an app for that, right? Budgeting apps consider lots of things. And so it's great to look into those, especially the free budgeting apps. And they can allow you to link your bank account and separate your expenses into different categories like rent or loans, groceries, or your entertainment costs. And you can actually set a budget for each category to keep your expenses organized and controlled. And you can take it with you anywhere if it's an app on your phone, which is super convenient. One of the apps that Stella, that you talked to earlier, she has recommended this, so you know it's tried and true, the Buddy Easy Budgeting app. And it helps you set a budget and keep track of your expenses either by yourself or together with your parents or anyone that you trust to help you. So there's a really great option for you. There's also the Spending Tracker, and by tracking your spending, you will be able to stick to your budget and save money, which is wonderful. So here you see examples of what some of these budgeting apps look like on the inside, and where you can really see those expenses broke down and easy for you to follow. And then, of course, we want to pay ourselves first, right? That's really one of the biggest things that you can do for financial success. So when you get that first paycheck, you really want to think about what you're saving for. And in the past, you may have planned to save money at the end of the month, but the reality is that you probably didn't have a whole lot left over. I know it was that way whenever I first started dealing with expenses and finances and all of these things as you're coming into adulthood. And so you probably, I know I spent it on all of my need expenses and some of the wants. But rather than saving money only if you have money left over, it really works much better if you can set some money aside at the beginning when you first get that paycheck, and make it an amount that no matter what happens, you can take it out of your paycheck and put it into savings and not touch it. So even if that's just $5 a month, or if it's a 10% of your paycheck, however you want to do it, anything that you can put in there at the beginning when you first get paid is really going to benefit you overall. You also want to think about, you know, what is it that you want and what are you saving for? And that really can be your motivation to keep putting money into that savings account. So you want to save money for your future, right? So for expensive purchases like a home, or maybe, you know, you want some work done to your car or to buy a car, for special occasions like a birthday or a vacation. A lot of us save for entertainment like movie or concert tickets. Things like that. And then, of course, it's always good to have money in there for an unexpected emergency, like a broken refrigerator, or if you have to get a new laptop for school or college or your job, or if you have to have car repairs. It's really good to have that money set aside somewhere, because things happen that we don't expect. So there are some great tools here that you can access if you receive money from Social Security income. And a lot of people think that if you receive Social Security, that will stop if you work or if you have a savings account. And so there is good news, because it is possible to save money and be able to keep your Social Security payment. And so the three most common ways to save money are a PASS account, a special needs trust, or an individual development account, or an IDA. And I will touch briefly over these, but if you need more information, definitely contact somebody that you trust, or us at Kentucky Spin, and we can give you more information. But the plan to achieve self-support, or the PASS program, is for people with disabilities who plan to work or are working. And it's possible to set up a savings account through Social Security, and they will allow you to set aside money for a specific item or service that is needed for a work goal. The money that you have in that account won't be counted against your resource limit. A pass account can make it possible for you to save money. If you need a down payment for a vehicle to help you get to a job or for a computer that will allow you to start your own business, things like that, that's a really good option. A special needs trust is another way that you can save money and not be penalized for it. A family member or a friend can establish a trust on your behalf. A trust can be used to pay for big expenses like a trip or to visit family, a new computer or a TV. And it could be a good way to plan for your future. Family members and friends can also deposit money into the trust for you. So that's a great idea. And then a trust, it can't be used to pay for regular things like groceries or bills or rent. But to find out more, you can speak with a lawyer who has experience with special needs trust. And if you need help getting in contact with somebody, again, feel free to reach out to us and we will get you connected with the right person. There's also individual development accounts, and those programs are there to help people with low income save money for things like education, starting a business, or buying assistive technology that they may need. And so for every dollar that a person puts into an IDA, the program will add a dollar and sometimes even more before you can receive but before you can receive them matching the amount, you'll have to agree to rules and make regular contributions, things like that. And so I really like this cat here. It says, yes, you read me right, treat yourself. So I do encourage you guys to treat yourself. And you know, after you've put your paid yourself first and put that money in savings and paid all your expenses, definitely, you know, try and take a little bit of that hard-earned money because you worked for it, right? And get something that you enjoy, whether that's going out to eat with your bestie, excuse me, you know, or going to grab an ice cream cone or going to get your hair and nails done, set aside something, or maybe just a new outfit or a pair of shoes. Set aside something that you've been looking forward to and that you can really do to enjoy that first paycheck because you earned it. All right. So if anybody has any questions, you just feel free to contact us at Kentucky Spin. There's our phone number and our website. And I believe Kelly is going to share a video with us to kind of recap what we've talked about today.
This is John. And he's just gotten a job. Like many of us, John struggles with money management, budgeting, saving, understanding his paycheck. In the past, it has caused him to feel overwhelmed because budgeting is hard, paychecks are confusing, setting goals is complicated. Poor John. That is before this presentation. Today's session solved all those problems for John. After today's session, paychecks have been explained. Banks, credit unions, and check cashing services make more sense. He knows different ways to access his money. Budgeting will be easier with the tools, ideas, and apps he learned about.
Financial goals can be made. John's so excited, he wants to test drive the tools he was given today. So he goes to www.kyspin.com for free resources and assistance. Wow! Look how happy John is. www.kyspin.com. It's free.
Well, again, we want to thank everyone for joining us today. Rhonda, did you have any wrap-up comments before I get into some information about evaluation?
Yeah, I just wanted to thank you all so much for having us. We've enjoyed this so much. And please let us know, and as the video had stated, there's actually a tab on our website that says youth/adult. And you can find resources under that. There's resources for your family, for teachers on our website. And we are adding more and more information, videos, webinars that have been previously recorded. So please access that. Contact us if we can help. We have really enjoyed our time with you all. I hope you have too. Thank you.
And we want to thank Kentucky Spin again. You all have been great to work with. And thank all the participants.